Tages in Tinte.
Life as you mentored us with yours.
We thank you, Lord, for those blessings. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus the Christ. The one that brings new life to old. The one that brings into our world a difference in the way we live, that others may see. Others may wonder. And others may come and follow you as well. We thank you, Lord, for those blessings. Hear us as we pray together. We call out together the prayers and the praises that are on our heart and in our minds. For Betty and our families.
For Jean, for Marge and Joe, for Ruth and her family, for Dick and Shirley.
We thank you.
And also for Jane, we know.
Hear our prayers, Lord.
For the Martin family.
For those we love.
Don Johnson.
For those we miss.
Praise for Charles this week.
We thank you, Lord, for those who serve.
For Ellie.
Praise for Trinity and all children.
For K2 and Stephanie and K3. We thank you.
For those that couldn't be with us today.
Be with them.
For Pastor Don and Jerry.
Mm-hmm.
For the kingdom. For those who serve.
For friends.
For Pastor Ken, who has to take a special trip tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
We've lifted up to you those things that are troubling to us and those who love us and we love them. We ask you, Lord, to make a permanent place in their lives and in their hearts, that they too may join us in sharing your gospel message, in sharing a life different than the life of this world. And we ask you, Lord, to hear us as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Our stewards to come forth for the morning offering and our young people to come for the children's message. Oh man, it's such a hard job. How can anybody be expected to do it 2 weeks in a row? Think of the crown, the jewels in your crown you're making for when you get to heaven, which is a long way off. You've got plenty of room on that crown. We're going to pray first.
Where are you
going? I love you like my own son. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to serve you. And as we reveal our gifts to the kingdom, we ask you to take these morsels and turn them into a banquet that makes the kingdom grow. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. I'm so excited that you guys are here today because I did some research for this morning so that I can give you something to take with you. One of the blessings that we have as human creatures is the way we look. And the way we look is kind of the way God looks. So in our heart and in our mind, we think of God in kind of human ways. So if you were to look at a photograph of Jesus, it would be a very similar photograph to God, because God is Jesus' Father, our Father. And so if we think of the generations after generations of God, we kind of look like God, and God kind of hopes we act like God. That's why Jesus came to mentor us, to say, this is the way we're supposed to live. And we look at Jesus and go, boy, that guy was something else, wouldn't he? One of the things that makes us look like God is the hair on his head. I went to find the hair on my head. We all kind of start out in the same place. Can you even guess how many hairs are on your head when you're born? I know what happens to it when you get old, but when you're born, can you even guess? Well, you have hair follicles all in your ear. That's what I'm talking about. How much hair are you born with? Oh. I don't know if you heard that. I'm going to have to get a microphone up here. He said, we're born with all of it.
We're born with all of it.
And that's the truth.
That's true.
And how much do you think is right there? Can you guess? 10? 20, 50, 100? Well, you were getting there until you jumped into the millions. We don't have millions of hair follicles.
Y'all look like me.
That's scary.
Yes.
Great. That's really scary.
I can't even give you credit for that one. We're born with somewhere between 100 and 150,000 hair problems. And if our families give us enough stress, we lose some of that over time. But you probably have 125,000 strands of hair. And God knows exactly that number for you. And for you. And you. You. All of you. God knows every hair on our head. That's how much God cares about us. To know the details of who we are. Because God created each and every one of us. And to think that God knows exactly how many strands of hair are on our head is just mind-boggling to me. Because someone who cares that much for us, to know even the most delicate detail of who we are, we must really be important to God. Now, how can we show God how important God is to us? We can tell. We don't have to tell God how many strands of hair he has. But we can show God that kind of love by the way we live. We can live like Jesus did. Loving and caring other people. Talking to them about how they're supposed to live if they're godly people. And if they're not, how important it is to be godly people. God loves you enough to know exactly how many hairs are on your head. Isn't it easier for us to show God how much we love God by sharing who God is with other people? That'll give you something to talk about. So how many hairs are on your head? 125,000. I think we have blonde hair. Dark hair up to 150,000 strands of hair. That's too big for me to even understand. That's like one strand of hair for everybody that lives in Gainesville. Mm. And it's all on your head. Let's put God on our heart. And pray with me one more time. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
We love you for loving us.
We love you for loving us.
Give us strength and courage.
Give us strength and courage.
To share that love. With the world around us. I love you, Jesus. And all the children say.
Amen.
Have a great children's church. Take my word for it. You don't have to count this thing.
What's greater, strands of hair or grains of sand?
Oh my goodness, okay. This next week.
Got to do research on that.
And the lives we live inspire. 31.
I turned it on.
Well, good morning again to each and every one of you, and I'm blessed that your presence will light up the kingdom, not only here, but as we leave this place. This morning's passage is the Gospel of Matthew, the 10th chapter, the 24th through the 39th verses. I've entitled my message, Godly Worth. So I start this morning with a question for you. Is your relationship with God as important as God's relationship with you? Food for thought. As you mull that around in your mind and in your heart, I would encourage you not to get fooled by the ways of this world. As you have learned to live and you have learned to love, does it make a difference? You see, we as Christians are the last hope for this world. It is what we do. It is what we've taken on. It is the sharing of God's love in such a remarkable way that it gives hope to a world that lives mostly in darkness. So I encourage you, stand strong with God who loves you so much that all else is second best. You find in your bulletin and your little tab on your little tent on your table that says God first. And I found this blue ribbon award that says God on it. So we give God first place. That's the essence of the message that Matthew was writing about for this morning. Place God first in your life. Lift high the cross. Each of us is given a cross to carry and the burden that comes with. But it also comes with the joy and peace that becomes more than just a symbol. It is a statement of your commitment to the kingdom. And it is how you will live as you grow in kingdom worth and godly worth. We're going to turn to Matthew now, the 10th chapter. So if I told you there were 28 chapters in the book of Matthew, and we're on the 10th chapter, and Matthew begins where? With the birth of Christ. And ends where? With the ascension of Christ. Would you believe me if I told you that we're right in the middle of God's story? Words of wisdom are where we start with Matthew's message for us for this morning. A student is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the student to be like the teacher, and the servant like his master. If the head of the household has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his own household. So do not be afraid of them. There is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from the will of your Father. And even the very hairs on your head are numbered, some more than others. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows.
Whoever acknowledges me before men will go, will also, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before men, I will disown them before my Father in heaven. It is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. We've been talking in our learning hour, we've been talking as we gather in fellowship about God's knowledge. God knew before. God knows now. And God knows everything in the future. And some of the things we think about as humans, we can only wonder why. Why do things happen if God already knew? Maybe the answer to that is only answered with, because God knows how everything will turn out. And in this love affair that God has with us and we have with God, isn't there a calling to share in the kingdom work of knowing and caring and sharing and recruiting us to the world? Which is what God did for us as a mentor. And so it's kind of a follow-on to the messages that Matthew's been giving to us for some time now, and to the world for several millenniums. Jesus has just sent out his 12 disciples, his 12 apostles, into the world. That's where we are in the middle of the book of Matthew. He's chosen those special 12. He sent them out into the world now. And last week, I think we related like sheaves among wolves. And Jesus tells them, go without anything. Well, wear your robe, your sandals, but don't take spares. Don't take cash, not even a credit card. Go into the world to make a difference. But the one thing he tells them that makes it better, go without fear. Jesus' point that Matthew so articulates is that there's truly nothing in this world that can be worse. Worse than what you say. Well, you say, what if I go out and they kill me? The words of Matthew, the words of Jesus, don't worry about the one who can kill your body. Worry about the one who takes your body and your soul. And the name was Beelzebub. That's just a fancy name for Satan. Beware of what Satan can do to you in this world. Because God will save you, and God will save your soul. True story, we were in ministry. We had left the corporate world behind. We had been appointed by the bishop to make a difference in the community. It was a rebuild of a church that had kind of forgotten the doctrines and the way that they were called to serve. The one thing that Candy and I learned is that there's a hierarchy in every faith community that is established of what they choose to hear as their calling, sometimes from God and sometimes not so much. And we were called to bring change and to round them up into the doctrines of that denomination. Change is hard. The older I get, the less I want to change. You can relate to that, maybe. You still have plenty of time to face it, but the truth is, the older I get, the less I want to make differences in my life. Well, in this situation,
the founding families had made their decision on the way it should be. Not the way God called me to bring change. There were about 50 in the congregation when we arrived, about 200 when we left, but the truth is that there were a group of people who were not excited about the differences that were going on and changes that were being made. And I was in my office one day when there was a knock on the door. I opened the door and opened it. It was one of the leaders of the faith community, and certainly a leader in that community. Come on in and sit down. He says, well, first of all, he says, I want to talk to you about something that's troubling me. And I want to start out by telling you that we love you and Candy very much, which is the reason that I'm here. And this person went on to say that it would be such a dreadful event if while you were sleeping, the parsonage burned down. There were a few other things said in that office, and before I invited him to escort himself out. But I take comfort in the passage for today that tells us that the world can only take your body, they can't take your soul. What a difference we make in a world that doesn't want change. And yet, those with the confidence, empowered by the Holy Spirit, have the ability to stand firm for Christ in our world. Jesus said, do not be afraid. You know, one of the things I've told you that changed my life and allowed me to accept this role in ministry was that Jesus said to the disciples and to us, don't worry, I'm going to be with you always. Which means, to me, what I heard Jesus say is, you don't have to do this on your own. The only thing that's stronger than those words to my ministry are the ones that he said, don't worry, I will be your representative to the Father. What you do on earth is how I respond to God the Father. I think of my life, and I think of you, and the love that we share together in the fellowship of Christ. And I think that the thing that drives fear in us is sin. It's so common. And haven't we discussed that God's vision of sin is all one thing? Now, in my humanness, I try to think that if I slip and say a bad word, that's just a little bitty sin. But if I were to go out and kill somebody, that'd be a great big sin. And surely, certainly, God would see that different. But the truth is that we've studied, that we believe, that we understand. We believe that we understand that sin is sin. God abhors sin. And it doesn't matter whether you say a bad word or do something disastrous. It's all sin to God. And I think of those things when God talks about the sparrows. Did you get that point in the reading of Matthew? They had these sin sacrifices, right? And for poor people and small sins, you could buy 2 sparrows for a penny. Now, a penny was worth a lot more then than it is now. If you did the math and
Well, anyway, they were cheating. And if that's all the sin that you had, or if that's all the money you had, you could buy two sparrows and they would sacrifice them to relieve you of that sin, which we figured out that truly doesn't work. And then we hear Matthew say from Jesus, God knows every hair on your head. It's easier for some of us to believe that God can count that high. But what it does is it is a transformation of who we were to who we are becoming, because we start to understand this relationship between Jesus Christ, God the Father, the Holy Spirit, and us. And the life we live, no matter whether you have a lot of hair on your head or not, God knows. Now, if you said that outside, they might ask you, God knows what? God knows everything. God knows before. God knows now. God knows in the future. God knows what you are going to do, how you're going to respond, and then sometimes what he has to do to clean up your mess, I guess. I have this whole list of things I want to ask God when I get there, but I don't think I'll need the list when I get there. Because God says there in time, all things will be revealed. Nothing will be hidden. I know that's not today, because I know there are some answers that I can't figure out. We live day by day in this world. And from that vantage point, there's a lot of scary stuff that's going on. I see the news. I see what's going on in our community. And there's a lot of good things still happening. But there's a lot of scary threats that are happening to our people, to God's people, to our world. And this passage confronts us with, what are you going to do when you are threatened by the world? How many of us can sit back and say, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me? How many of you can sit back and say, I read it in Matthew, you can only kill me? That doesn't bring a lot of peace to my heart. I know my soul belongs to God, but I'd like to take it there naturally. The fact is, most of us fear something. And that's unavoidable. You see, there's this involuntary reaction to threats. But they can be a positive thing, because they invoke upon us as human creatures this sense of fight or flight. So if you're outnumbered, you better run. I think that's what I meant by that. There have been studies that sometimes fear is healthy, because it gets you going and it forces you to make decisions that will be responding to your lifestyle and your commitment to Christ. Now, when I prepare for Sunday morning, I do a lot of study. I have a library of maybe 10,000 books that Candy has read most of them. I have access to the internet. I have subscriptions to things. And I came across this guy, Robert Fulghum. It struck out to me because there was a guy that lived around the corner from us as I was growing up. His son, Steve, was one of my friends. His name was Robert, but it's a different one. This Robert Fulghum is an author. And he's famous for a book, All I Really Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. And much of his resources and research happened because he lived across the street from an elementary school. And as he'd sit on his porch drinking coffee, he would catch some of the conversations and some of the things that were going on from the actions the people had as the parents dropped off the children for school and the teachers took care of the kids while they were there. But he also was close enough to watch the children where they played together. You see, there was this field right next to him, a vacant lot right next to him, and the kids would all come there to play. And one day, the children were playing hide-and-go-seek. You remember that time in your life when, oh my gosh, I can't wait because I know a perfect hiding place. We like to play it at night. That made it a little more exciting. Even a little fat boy like me could find a place in the shadow. But hide-and-go-seek was a fun game, and he was observing, and he watched each of the children. And they'd find places, and they'd run, and they'd look and sneak out the people. They'd tap them, and the others would run. What is that? Ollie, ollie, in, free, and... But there's one child who came up to the edge of his property, and the leaves from the fall had made this real big pile of leaves. And he so astutely got under there and flipped the leaves over the top of him.
Oh, no.
Needless to say, they had no clue where he was. But the game was starting to wind down. They still hadn't found him. So he opened his window and yelled to the kid, "Get found! Get found!" See, that's something we don't have to worry about with God. Because God won't ever forget the creatures that God loved more than any of his creations. If God knows every sparrow that hits the ground, knows every hair on your head, there's no way you can hide in a pile of leaves from God. The last message that Jesus shares with us was troubling to me, troubling to us. We talked a little bit about it before, mainly because we often relate Jesus to peace. But sometimes that allows us to gloss over the differences for the sake of superficial harmony. Jesus speaks of coming not to bring peace, the kind of peace that Jesus speaks of will occur just not here or now. But when he talks about a division between families, when he talks about a difference between a father and a son, a mother and a daughter, it's hard for me to understand exactly what Jesus was trying to get across. And as I dug deeper and deeper, it relates to our little table tents and our bulletin graphic. Jesus wasn't trying to separate us from our family. Jesus was keeping us from being separated from God. Put God numero uno. Place God first. Place God before all things. I used to hear, it's God first, family second, work last. I used to hear that a lot because Candy would say it to me. I said, so I'm in quandary here if God and work are the same. Nice try, big guy, she said. So we must address the question that's embedded in the text for Matthew to write of what Jesus said. What title do we give to our godly worth? Found a couple of curious questions to ponder. They came to me as I was referring to this Robert Fulghum book, Everything I Needed to Learn Was From Kindergarten. He gathers his thoughts as he's thinking about his school experience and the one that across the street. See if you've ever heard these questions before. Generally pointed at you like this. What on earth have you done? As a child, I think we heard that more. Maybe even as a child, we've heard this one. What in God's name are you doing? What were you thinking? What will you think of next? And that brings to us the final question, who do you think you are? And now change the context of those questions. Change them from the parent asking the child to God asking the question, what on earth have you done for the kingdom? In my name, what are you doing? I know, but what were you thinking? I also know, what are you going to think of next? Who exactly do you think you are? Because I already know. If you put those questions into a godly context, it changes your point of view of how God incorporates our lives into God's love. But you know what they may do? They just may reveal to you who God is in your life. Think about it. And all the children say,
amen.
Amen. Amen.